it's probably, you know, a lot higher than what I did. It's an individual sport. If I had a bad game, I got Scottie Pippen and Dennis Rodman and some of these other guys that carry me a little bit. But for him, you know, you got to be on your game each and every day that you step on that golf course. People try to defuse it by not being in the same season. I mean, they're counting him right now, and that's carrying over from one season to the next. I mean, so it's how people perceive it, you know, and I think it's one of the greatest feats.
After the champions' dinner that night, Mr. Woods decided he was going to do a little celebrating with his friends. And he went up, got in the car, and he and his friends put the funkiest music on that you could imagine, and then made Down Magnolia Lane with all this booming noise, laughing their heads off, being kids.
During the Tiger Slam, with the remarkable margins of victory at Pebble Beach and St. Andrews, Tiger was dominating the game like no other golfer before him.
Yeah, it wasn't any fun for the competitors to lose by that many.
I think for many, many times, people were always, not necessarily intimidated, but were a little bit in awe of what Tiger could do. So if they saw him moving up the leaderboard, they're like, oh, you know, here comes Tiger Woods. He's capable of doing anything.
He had this ability to, you know, get his name on the leaderboard, and everybody just would freak out. Everybody could not handle it. Tiger Woods, oh my goodness. I mean, I've got to compete with him. You know, instantly you'd start saying bogey over here, double bogey two holes away by this leader.
It's just they weren't capable of pulling off the types of shots that they had to in order to catch him. And that way the gap got bigger. They fell back. He kept going forwards. It was like watching a tank going through, you know, a shanty town, just crushing everything in his way.
Tiger had looked fatigued in the last three majors of 2001. On his return to Augusta in 2002, he was revitalized. He made his move on Saturday, from three shots behind to a share of the lead.
We were back out in the afternoon and played with Jose Maria, a good friend of mine, and I played probably the best round I've played that entire week. I hit it so good and made so many putts. It was just a solid round of golf.
During the final round, Tiger turned up the heat.
Hit a bad tee shot on 13 and then tried to play through the trees and didn't work out. And actually hit a pretty decent shot into the green. It just happened to catch the creek and roll in. And VJ did the same thing. Actually had a good second shot into the green, just barely caught the ridge and actually rolled in the creek.
BJ had made nine, already made eight over 13, and those powers to influence others, even when you're not trying to, that's a very hard thing to get. And it's like this book, The Celestine Prophecy, where there's like this magnetism coming, you know, out of your skin, invisible. You can't see it, but it has the ability to change others. That's what it felt like. That's what it looked like. And the others reacted as though they were feeling those invisible powers casting a spell on them.
Tiger won by 3 shots, and although his third green jacket was a comfortable fit, its owner was still unsure of its color.
No, it's definitely not a green that you'd be wearing around all the time. But it sure looks nice in your closet.
Tiger's 8th and most recent major followed at the 2002 U.S. Open.
To get 8 so early in my career is it's a big bonus, because you don't want to, if you're trying to chase down and hopefully one day pass a record such as Nicklaus's that is so far out of reach, you have to get a head start on it.
Since then, majors have proved to be elusive.
Once you're able to break through that invisible ray of influence, you're never going to be shielded by it again. That's what we're seeing now. That invisible wall has come down. I don't think it ever goes back up, but that doesn't mean he's not going to win major championships.